Okay, awesome. We are ready to go. Hi, everybody. I think you probably remember me from the first couple days, but my name is Catherine Kuhn, and I am one of the organizers here, and it's my privilege to be able to be with you this morning to talk to you about Google Earth Engine. So welcome. Before we start, a couple of process points. If you get lost or stuck today during the tutorial, there's a lot of different ways that you guys can get help. So you can check the tutorial contents online on GitHub. I talk kind of really fast, and so there's online support and explanations for most of the things that we're doing. I try to be pretty verbose in the written part. You can use your sticky notes. We have two amazing TAs who are here. Can you wave, TAs? Victoria and Simon is somewhere. He might have stepped out for a moment. But they are experts in Google Earth Engine, and they can help answer your questions while we're going through the tutorials. You can also ask your peers. I know there's people in this room. Some people have even sat in part of this training. Other people have tinkered with Earth Engine on their own. And lastly, we have a Slack channel for Google Earth Engine. And today we have the privilege of having two of the developers from Earth Engine join us on that Slack channel, Tyler Erickson and Nick Clinton. And so you can go onto that Slack channel if you have questions during the tutorial that you are too shy to ask or you don't want to stop the presentation, and you can ask them and they might be able to help you out. So that is how we can kind of navigate today. I call it going slow to go fast. If you've ever watched a professional climber, you'll see they're very deliberate in their moves and slow. So in the beginning, we're going to start out kind of baby steps just to get into the platform. And then at the end, I'm going to let you guys just go. And then you can explore a little bit on your own. All right, so with that being said, let's go ahead and move into the tutorials. So I'm on this page. You already did episode, like the getting access to Earth Engine, and we'll check that in a second. So we're going to skip ahead and go ahead into the introducing Earth Engine. And the purpose of today's tutorial is not for me to stand up here for 50 minutes and explain to you why you should use this platform. But I do want to give you a little context so you understand why it may or may not be useful for you and your questions. So this first part will be very short, and then we'll move into the more interactive coding part. So what is Google Earth Engine? And the answer is it's a cloud-based platform for planetary-scale geospatial analysis that is made by Google, and more specifically, this part of Google called Google Earth Engine. And Noel Gorelick wrote this amazing paper in Remote Sensing the Environment that came out last year that offers a really great overall explanation of what the platform is and how it works that I highly encourage you to go look up and read in all your free time. The next thing that you might think in your mind is, okay, so that's what Google Earth Engine is. Why would I use it? And what I'm going to do in this part is I'm going to give you a series of reasons why you might use Google Earth Engine. And maybe these apply to your research, maybe they don't. So as we saw yesterday in Matt Hansen's really amazing talk where he demoed some of the stories that you can find in his global maps of land cover change, one of the first reasons why you want to use Google Earth Engine is because you can do planetary scale science with it. And this is really groundbreaking and something that's just come about in the last few years since Google Earth Engine came online. And as Matt said, which I'm not sure if I agree with because it's a little confusing because it's a company, but they kind of have democratized access to these algorithms and these data sets in a way that's made research on much larger scales possible. In the tutorial, I've listed three what I call celebrity use cases, starting with Matt's global forest watch product that you can go online and map forest change at a global scale. This data set, as he mentioned, is available in Earth Engine for you to compute on. And I included in this celebrity use case number one, as an example of planetary scale computing, links to both the paper and a tutorial in Earth Engine if you want to step through and explore his data set in more details. Two more celebrity use cases. Other people were like, wow, you just mapped forest loss and gain on a global scale. That's pretty cool. Can we do it with water? And so in 2016, in December of 2016, the European Commission's Joint Research Center released a similar data set built on Landsat, but that's for water. So it's mapping loss and gain of water, the ephemerality of water, across the whole globe over the Landsat archive. It's a phenomenal data set for anybody who's in freshwater sciences. And I've included some links again to the paper that was published in Nature, the data set, some different ways to explore the data, and the data user's guide here for you to play with later if you'd like. The third celebrity use case that just came out, which is really cool, it's not very related to my research, but I'm excited to learn more about it, is a study that they just published about 2015. It's a global map of travel times to cities. And so they're trying to assess inequalities in healthcare access, and they made a heat map that shows how far away any given individual lives or any pixel in the globe is from healthcare. Another really cool planetary scale data set released in Google Earth Engine and made possible by our ability to kind of crawl these massive data repositories of public satellite imagery. So planetary scale analysis is one reason why you might want to use Earth Engine. A second reason is free cloud processing with built-in functions. So when you log onto the JavaScript GUI to do your processing in the code editor, they've already made this really nice application for you, and they're taking care of all of the cloud processing in the background. They take care of all the parallelization decisions and the cloud infrastructure on the back end, and you don't really have to, you can just kind of focus on your code and the questions that you want to ask. So you no longer have to download any individual images at a time or figure out like where you're going to put all your images on your computer. The third reason is Google has a massive online public data archive, and you can even request data sets if there's something that they don't have that you want on there. So they have multiple petabytes of satellite imagery, including, of course, our favorite Landsat mission, all online for you to play with, and lots of other data sets available. They're listed in table one of that paper that I mentioned if you want to browse them. And then, of course, on the Google Earth Engine website, there's a whole data set page where you can browse through and see different ones that are available. But it ranges, is a huge range of data, everything from precipitation, topography, land cover, climate, population density, and they're just adding data all the time, which is really cool. But if for some reason they don't have something that you want, another reason why you might use Earth Engine is because you can upload your own data. So you can upload your own raster and vector data into Earth Engine, and of course you can also export your own raster and vector data as well. You do have limits on how much you can use, and that can, depending on which way you're accessing Earth Engine, your limits might be a little bit different. But it is really cool that you can bring in your own data into this platform. You didn't used to be able to do that when they first started Earth Engine. So reason number five is they even take care of version control for you now. This is another new feature. Google will back up your code in a Git repository. You don't even know what's happening. You don't have to do any of the Git add, Git push. You just like write in your code and then you save it and then it's backed up on Git, which is pretty fantastic. And you can also share code with other people. And reason number six is there's several different ways to access Google Earth Engine. And so Google Earth Engine, there's like a master API that you call into, and there's a GUI that you could take anyone who's a non-programmer and they can explore some of the satellite imagery in that interface. There's the JavaScript API, which is what we're going to be doing today, what we'll be using. The reason why we're using the JavaScript API today, which I know you might be like, but we've done all this programming in Python, what are you doing? The JavaScript API is like a web interface that the developers have made for us to make it really easy for us to visualize our data outputs. And so we're going to use that today to help us kind of learn how Earth Engine works. And then if you want to get into more advanced programming, you can also call in through a Python API, which will look kind of similar to what Shay was showing you when you call into S3 Bucket, where you have to go through this authentication process and pull data out and compute on it in your browser. And I'm happy to talk more about that either on Slack, ask the developers questions, or we can maybe even have a pop-up section about Python and Earth Engine later. But for today, for learning and visualization, it's really great to start with the JavaScript API, which is what we'll be working in today. So kind of very broadly, how does it work? Using the code editor, in our case, which is the JavaScript like GUI that they've written for us, you write commands that are sent as an object to Google for processing, and then they send you back what you asked for. So you make a request in the JavaScript GUI, and then it goes in. They split your requests up and deal with all the cloud processing in the back end, and then they give you back what you asked for. And there's three things in Earth Engine. There's the geospatial data sets themselves. There's the compute servers where you're like actually running the codes that you're sending, the requests and the functions that you're asking for. And then they've also developed all these algorithmic primitives. So it's really nice because, for example, when I first started using Earth Engine, I had to hand code out how to make a stratified random sample. Now there's a function that's like stratified random sample, and I just call that, and it runs it for me. So they've done a lot of work building algorithmic primitives for a lot of the basic programming tasks that you might want to do. So you don't have to actually like hard code them all yourself, which is great. Okay, so just to wrap up, what are some of the common uses of Earth Engine? If you want to operate on large scale data sets, remote sensing imagery in particular, it's great. You can embed the outputs in apps. You can store, share, and version control your code. You can import and export your own raster and vector data. You can share your own raster and vector data, and you can also share your code. And then you can export your analysis and do whatever else you want in some other platform. What are the limitations, you might ask? Well, what is Earth Engine not designed for? It's really not designed for beautiful cartography. So if you want to make a really highly stylized map that's very complex, this is not the application for you. It's not really meant for interactive data visualization with non-programmers. It's the thing that Google is really good at is crunching through petabytes of data. And then they've kind of built around that some tools to make it easier to visualize what you're doing. But at its core, it's really an analysis machine, not a visualization machine. It also has some trouble with heavy-duty vector operations. And the other thing is you have to be willing to let Google do all the parallelization for you. So if you have more complex parallelization needs, then perhaps you might not want to use this platform. And if you have questions about that, the developers are great people to ask about it because they would know a lot more than I would about what exactly they're doing in the back end.
I have a question about we know this free for Google comes with some price, or what is it that they're getting?
Great question.
Especially if you're uploading your own data.
Ask the developers. They keep just saying it's free, and I'm like, okay. So there's a cost model now. If you are using commercial data, I believe, or commercial analysis, when you click to your waiver button, they flag you if you're doing commercial development with Earth Engine, and then I think there's a cost model to pay. And the other thing you may have noticed if you are a user is that Google Earth Engine, and maybe Nick and Clinton will correct me if I'm wrong, or Nick and Tyler, but it sort of developed separately from the rest of Google. And so initially, the Landsat archive is stored somewhere as part of Earth Engine, and it's not actually the same version that's stored in Google's cloud platform that's publicly available. And the same thing with BigQuery, the algorithms that they use in Earth Engine, they're not exactly the same as what is used in the rest of Google. So I think what is happening is they're sort of becoming more integrated, but I don't know where the overarching, since I started using this platform, I don't know how many years ago, that's a question that people always ask, and it's still available, so I'm gonna keep using it. Yeah, and there isn't, that I know of, any plan to make it commercial at this moment, but at any moment they could make it commercial. So that's just definitely something to be aware of. This is not truly open source. Yeah. Okay, great question. Anybody else have any other questions before we go on to the code editor? So that's meant to be a super quick and dirty just overview of what Earth Engine is, so you kind of understand how it fits in this ecosystem of all these different tools that we're using. Now let's go ahead and actually go to Earth Engine and start to get our hands dirty, because that's the fun part. So I'm going to take this and I'm going to scooch it halfway over, and then I'm going to go over my browser, and you can see I'm in the second tutorial, and the code editor overview, there's a link right here to kind of the full Google Earth Engine help page for this. There's a link at the top of all these tutorials, this is an important note, to the full code that we use here. So if you're a person who is a slow typer, or you do not like typing in every single line for whatever reason, in every session, there's a link to the code that we use, and you can just open that and run it, and it'll be the full code for that session. But for our purposes, we wanna go to the code editor and start from scratch so we can actually code along. So the URL is code.earthengine.google.com, and it's written right here in Getting Started. To access the code editor, type the following URL into your browser. And this is the place that we go to compute. So this is the JavaScript interface that they've built for us. And every month, it gets new features and new buttons. And since I started using it, it's really come a long way. And there's so many more features and functionalities than there used to be. It's really quite fantastic. And what we're going to do in this module is we're just going to step through some of the key parts of this code editor so that you understand where things are located. It's an orientation tour. And again, you can refer back to the actual tutorial if you get lost or want to just kind of go through it at your own pace. So the first thing that you'll notice here is there is a box at which you can write code. So let's write our first little line, and we're just going to make it a comment. So this is a comment. Type that into your code editor. And then in order to get the code to actually go, you got to click run. So click the run button. And you'll notice that absolutely nothing happens. It's incredibly boring. Why did nothing happen? Because nothing happens when you just have a comment in a code box, right? But you actually, if you're paying attention, you'll notice that what you could do is you could print something. So let's print our favorite Hello World quote. And if you have problems getting onto the code editor, please raise your hand or put your sticky note on the side, and one of the TAs will come around and help make sure that you can get on. Or you can also partner with a friend if for some reason you've catastrophically not been able to get on. So we're going to print Hello World in the code editor and then click run. What do you notice happens? Does anybody see any changes in your screen? Yeah, the little phrase that I put, the string that I put inside the print statement popped up over in the console. So the console is where Earth Engine tells you what you asked it. It's where you can print things. And when you issue a print statement, they will appear right there. But you'll also notice something else happen. There's a little eye right here. Can you see that eye? There's not a lot of prompting when you have code that's incorrect, but they will every once in a while give you some tips. So what it's telling me is it wants a semicolon. So we're going to put a semicolon there just to have nice clean code. Okay. And then we can run it again and you see it just looks the same, hello world. There's one other tiny thing that changed that you might not have noticed. If you look right here where it says new script, you can see there's actually an asterisk. And that asterisk happens when you open a new script and make a change. The asterisk means, hey, I'm not saved. I need to be saved. So what we're going to do is we're going to click the save button and we're going to save this script. Okay. And what's amazing, this is totally new and really exciting, is when you go to save as, you can actually add a commit message. Whoa. So that's really cool because they didn't used to have that. So I'm going to save this as my hack. What is this? This is episode 01, Geohack 18, whatever. Save it as whatever you want. And hit OK. And you'll see this little wheel turning. It's adding it to your personal code repository. So if you opened any of the static links of my code that I shared with you, you have now started a new trajectory, a new script that's being saved locally to your own with its own history of commits. If you don't make any changes to the script, like right now it's saved, so you'll notice the save button is grayed out. I can't save it because there's been no changes that have been made. Each of the scripts is backed up on Git. So if you go find your script over here, you'll notice there's a little arrow, or there's like a little circle like that. And if you click it, it'll pull up the Git history of that particular script. You can also put these scripts in directories if you'd like. And sometimes when you are using the folders for the scripts and then also the assets, it can be kind of slow. So just a warning. The other thing is if you rename the script, its revision history disappears. The backing up the codes on Git is a relatively new function. So if you have more in-depth questions about it, those would be great for the developers because it's even changed since last year. So the other thing that you can do, and this is another really, really important thing that I'm going to share with you, is now that you save the code, maybe you want to share the code with one of your buddies. You're like, I got stuck on this part, I don't know how to fix it. Can you take a look at it? So what you're gonna do is you're gonna come over here and you're gonna click Get Link. And does anyone notice what happened? Something changed, but it's sort of tricky to find it. Does anybody notice what happened? Yeah. Yeah, the URL changed. So at the top, it just said codeeditor.whatever.google.com. And now there's this long string of letters and numbers. This is the unique footprint, like photograph of your code at this moment. So I can take this link and I can drop it in Slack and I can just try it. Drop it in Slack with one of your buddies. They're going to open it up and it's going to be your exact code that you shared with them. Now, if they want to operate on it, they're going to be queued to save it. And once they save it, it will then be in their local repository. So it's not like a Google Doc where people are working on it at the same time. With these types of links, it's more that you can share a version with someone and then they can look at it. Happy to ask more questions about that. In our case, however, we wanted to work on from the same shared repository. So if you guys go, where's mine? You probably joined a repository, I hope, as part of the pre-event materials, and you can see the codes that we're working on here. And you have read-only access to them, so don't worry, you can't screw up my codes. If you open these and run them, they'll become your own copies to work off of, and that you won't affect the repository that I added you to. Okay, so how do you actually, the whole point of Google, the fun thing about it is accessing the amazing data sets in the cloud. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to load some imagery from the Google Earth Engine catalog into our code editor. To query the Google Earth Engine data catalog, we're going to load some Landsat imagery. And we're going to do that by going to this search toolbar. And in the search toolbar, we're going to type Landsat 8 Tier 1 TOA. And you'll see a list of rasters comes up. So I'm going to pick the first one. And I'm going to click import. What you'll notice is a new variable called image collection loads into the code editor in the imports pane, which is right here. And I'm going to rename it Landsat 8 TOA, like that, just by renaming it like that. And if you click the little pull down, you can see there's some information about what it is. So it's an object, it has properties, it lists all the bands, it's an image, it's cast as an image collection, and there's also an option to put in the trash if you are not happy with it. So one thing that's kind of, a lot of times when people are getting started with Earth Engine, it really throws them for a loop, is that there's oftentimes the developers want to make this platform as easy as possible for you to use, preferably with very little programming. So I think that they think that environmental scientists are bad programmers, so they're like, we'll give you some buttons, it's okay. So a lot of times there's more than one way to do things. So this is one way to import data. Another way to import data is if you go here and you click on this little blue square, like that, you'll see there's this line of JavaScript that says variable TOA image collection. If I copy that and put it down here, that is doing the exact same thing. That would be importing the collection into my script exactly the same as the workflow that we just did. So there's kind of like a point and click way to import it where you search for it and you click import. And there's also a way in JavaScript to just write it out. Variable Landsat TOA, call in this image collection, and the image collection that I want is the one with this ID. One other thing to note is that if you search for Landsat 8 TOA and you look for it here, you can find all this metadata about the image collection, including stuff about the bands, and then the key piece of information you want is this image collection ID right here. That's how we call the collections into Earth Engine. And so each different data set has its own unique ID, and you can use it to call the image collection, and each individual image also has its own ID, so you can just call in one individual image as well. Okay, cool, so we don't need both of these things in our script, so I'm gonna delete that, because it's already imported at the top for simplicity. And what we're gonna do is, we want to rename this Landsat 8 collection because we just in a very verbose mood this morning. Okay, and what I'm going to do down here is, so I've imported this and you click run, nothing happens. What? This is so boring. I thought I was going to look at some Landsat data. So let's try to print it and see what happens. So we're going to go print. We've called in this image collection. I'm so excited to look at this Landsat archive Matt Hansen's talking about. Click run. What's going to happen? What's going on? It's that moment when you're like, wait a second, I thought I had this figured out. What is the error message that you get? Your query has been aborted after accumulating too many elements. So think about it. What did we just ask the Earth Engine application to do? Exactly. We just ask it to print like thousands of images into the browser. And thank goodness the developers were smart enough to put in an error message to be like, you don't really want me to do that, right? Okay, so let me teach you a super handy little trick because you'll run into this problem all the time. We use print statements to understand what we're looking at when we're programming. And sometimes you'll have things that are too big to look at. So you want to look at just one part of it. So let's go print Landsat 8 collection dot limit 5 and click run again. And ta-da, it prints no problem. It's like, okay, here's the first 5. I'll let you look at those. And so these are the first 5. If you have this big image collection, these are the first 5 images in that collection. So there's image 1, and you can see the bands and the properties over here, image 2, all in a big stack. So that's pretty cool. And if you go over here in the console, you've now printed out this list of images, and you can get tons of information by reading through the metadata over here. All right, the next thing that we're gonna do is we wanna get Landsat data, not just like a stack of it. We wanna get it for a specific place and time. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use the geometry tools to pick a place on the map and filter the whole Landsat collection over the globe for that one place. And right now I'm really interested in thinking about Lake Powell. So I'm gonna type in Lake Powell, Arizona into my map. And you can type in anywhere that you want if you're interested in it. It's gonna take me to Lake Powell. And I'm going to use the geometry drawing tools to drop a point. So this is another one of those things where they've added these nice buttons over here to do this. You could also program it out by saying like variable point equals drop a point. But we're going to go the lazy way. And we're going to add a marker. So I'm going to click over here, add a marker. I'm going to drop it over Lake Powell. And oh, what do you notice happened? At the top, we have a new variable. It's a geometry. And it's a point that's at this lat and long. Okay, so that's pretty cool. What we're going to do is we're going to go in here, and again, this is another way that they've kind of taken some of the programming burden away from you. Instead of having to cast it in JavaScript with different lines of code and tell it what you want it to be, we can use this little interactive widget here, and we're going to say, okay, we want to call our geometry region of interest, or ROI, and we want to change it to be a feature collection. So how I did that, if you didn't quite catch that part, is you see over here, this is kind of like in QGIS or ArcMap when you turn on because I haven't used ArcMap in so long. When you edit a shapefile, you have to turn on the editing. So it's in point drawing right now, and I'm telling it, okay, let's edit the point. There's that little gray wheel right here. boop, and you click on it, and you can change different characteristics. You can change the color, the name, you can add properties, stuff like that. Okay, so now we have this new region of interest point, and we've dropped the point, we've cast it as a feature collection, and we're gonna use it to geographically filter the Landsat archive. And we're gonna filter it to our study area, we're gonna filter it to just 1 year of images, and then we're gonna sort these images by cloud cover, and we're gonna pick the least cloudy image, because today I want the least cloudy image over Lake Powell. So you can see this chunk of code right here that's in the tutorial, and you can either copy it or you can just write it out hand by hand, whichever you want. I'm gonna copy it because I'm lazy. Oop, and paste it over here. So it's saying, okay, it's saying give me this new variable named image, cast it as this type of Earth Engine object called an EE image. So go to the Landsat 8 collection, filter it to just my Lake Powell point, but it's not called Lake Powell, it's called ROI. Sorry, I just wanna make sure you're awake, okay? So that's the shapefile that I'm using, in this case, we would call it a feature collection because that's what they call it in Earth Engine. So it could be a point, a line, or a polygon, and in this case, it's a point. So filter it just to this point, filter it for just these dates. So take this whole stack of images and give me just these dates, just this point, and then of course, I only want the first 7 bands because I don't care about all the QA stuff. I just wanna know what it's the visible and near infrared. I'm gonna take that stack that I've sorted to, and I'm gonna sort it one more time, I'm gonna sort it by cloud cover, and then I'm gonna pull the first one out, which will be the least cloudy scene, okay? So we're taking this whole image collection, we're applying these filters, we're sorting it, and then we're gonna end up with one image. So click run, and what do you see happens? Did anyone notice anything happen? Nothing happened, right? They're like, yeah, that's cool, I did it for you, it's there. But you need to print it or visualize it in some way to see what the actual output is. So let's print this image that we made. So we're gonna go over here, we're gonna make a print statement, print image, and you can assign images tags before you print them to help you, like sort them out once you get a big list, so Lake Powell image. And here's my Lake Powell image that I printed, it's over here, you can see its bands, its properties. It was actually collected on August 19th, is the least cloudy image from this year. But that's really boring. We actually wanna be able to see this image. So let's add it to the map. How you add things to the map in Earth Engine is you use this map add layer command. So I'm gonna pass it the image that I wanna add to the map. These curly brackets are a placeholder that we're not gonna fill out now because we're gonna do it later, but it's just how you would visualize the image. So right now we're saying, you know what, Earth Engine, visualize it however you best see fit. And later we'll give you some specific parameters. And then I'm gonna give it the name that's gonna appear as I load it to the map, and I'm gonna call it my Landsat 8 image. So map add layer, click run, and ta-da, there it is, finally. We have a map. So you can see the tile has loaded. This is one Landsat 8 tile. I always forget, they're actually pretty big. And Lake Powell's a great study site because it falls basically under one path row, which is quite convenient. So there's my Landsat tile that I asked for. This is the least cloudy Landsat image over Lake Powell from this year. And so we've got this collection filtered down to this one image. Now, but the thing is, this sort of looks like crap, right? It doesn't really look very good. You can't see any detail, it's not in color. We want to make it look like a pretty natural color image like Landsat's capable of doing. So let's go ahead and fix the visualization parameters to make it a true color image. And we're gonna use some prior knowledge right now to do that. So I'm gonna go to this map add layer and I'm gonna add these visualization parameters right here. And it's basically saying use bands 4, 3, and 2, which are the natural color bands for Landsat, and give it these different visualization specific parameters for the maximum value and bands, that's right. Yeah, I gotta pass it. I'll just copy this whole thing. So I'm gonna give it some visualization parameters and I'm gonna call it better Landsat 8 image because it's gonna be that's way nicer. Okay, so if you go over to layers right here, you can see my better Landsat 8 image has been added. And just as an exercise, let's leave that first one there so we can compare them. So I'm gonna do a map add layer, image, no parameters, Landsat 8 image. Okay, let's run it again. another tricky thing. So this is another example where you can either write things out with code in JavaScript, or they've now made a widget to make your life easier. So if you go over to the layers, you can see the two layers that I've added. And you'll see it doesn't really look like there's much going on here until you move your mouse over, boom, there's a little gray wheel. That little gray wheel is a widget that will help you edit the visualization parameters for this image. So you can click on them, and you can see for the regular Landsat 8 image, it just visualized bands 1, 2, and 3. When I pass it the parameters, it's now instead visualizing bands 4, 3, and 2. And you can adjust the range here. And what's really nice is you can play with the range. So you can say, set the min and the max for the visualization as one standard deviation or 100%. So a lot of times I'll load imagery and I won't know what the best parameters are. So I'll use this widget to kind of play with the parameters to get the visualization that I want. You can also make it more or less opaque. And if you're really lazy, you can do this amazing thing where you're like, I don't even want to write out all that stuff. And you can click import, and it'll import those parameters as an object, and you can pass that object through your map add layer line, and it'll capture all of that information that's in that little widget right there. Okay, so that's how you add things to the map and visualize them. So we've successfully taken an image collection, and we filtered it, we ran it, we've printed it in the console. Let me show you some other things in the console that might be really helpful to you. And those are the inspector tab. So let's say that I want to know the specific value at some point. So I think that maybe Lake Powell is experiencing some algae bloom or something in the bottom, and I want to see like what the reflectance is in the green band. You can go over here to the inspector tab, click on it, and you'll see you now have crosshairs. And you can use those crosshairs. Actually, I'm really curious about what this structure is right here. I wish I had some high-res data to tell me if it's a dock or what, but I'm going to click on it to see what the reflectance is. And you'll see in the inspector tab, a little thing pulls up. It tells you where you clicked, the lat long, the zoom, and then of all the images that you have loaded, or objects that you have loaded, it'll tell you the information at that pixel. So it's a good way to find values. Sometimes when you load new imagery, you're not really sure what the range is. You're like, oh, is the scale 0 to 1, or is it 0 to 10,000? You can use the inspector to figure out individual points on your map to kind of start to understand the imagery that you're analyzing. So that's the inspector tab. It's pretty handy. All right. Oh, the other thing that's really cool they added over here, which I totally forgot until just now, is if you see this little blue box, you get this list of numbers, and you're like, okay, that's okay, but I want to know, what does it look like visually? Boom, it's a graph. You can click that, it'll make it a plot, and that is pretty handy if you want to be able to visualize it spectrally as a bar chart instead. It'll let you do that. Okay, I think we're pretty good. So the other thing you can do is you can, you know, change the dates, you can change, drop the point somewhere else, you can play with the map visualization parameters. But in the interest of kind of moving through this tutorial, I want to point out a few more things in the code editor, and then we're going to move on to the next one. Okay, so this is the most important thing I will tell you this whole session. If you get nothing else, this is the part you should listen to. You will have to teach Earth Engine to yourself. It is not a class that you can take at any university, as far as I know, right? So how are you going to do that? How are you going to teach yourself? Here are some ways that you can get help when you're trying to train yourself on how to use this platform. The first thing is the API reference. So if you go up here, there's a help button. And you can see there is a user's guide. Use the user's guide. I will guarantee you, if you are starting with this platform, whatever it is that you're going to do, there's probably a user's guide entry for it, and you can probably get the information and the code that you need here. In the user's guide, they go through every single task that you that is available to perform in Earth Engine, and they have documentation and example code snippets for you that you can work through. So if you want to do something in Earth Engine, this is where you start. You say, oh, I want to make a time series, and I want to make a plot that looks like this. Come here and look and see what the options are. The other place that you can get help is the help form. And this is really cool, and it's a treasure trove of overwhelming information. If you go to help, there's a help form button right here. And what it is a Google group where people post questions. The Google developers also post announcements here. So if they have a grant competition or if they have a new feature coming out, they'll have a little post in here to explain that. So I guarantee you, if you are a new Earth Engine user and you have a question, probably someone else at this point has already asked that same question. So go here and look and see if you can find that question. If you can't find the question here and you can't find it in the user's guide, then post the question here, because probably maybe other people in the world have that same question and other users might be able to answer it for you. This is an awesome treasure trove for inspiration, ideas, and assistance when you're using the Earth Engine platform. The other thing I use it for is like super science inspiration. Like, people are doing crazy things in Earth Engine. And if you're like, want to check it out and just kind of cruise around and see examples of the work, like, Google snowfields and just see what people are doing with snow and the what questions they're posting, and you'll stumble across some really cool code that way. Okay. The next thing is there are tons of existing tutorials and other Earth Engine for Higher Education resources that I have linked to on the Google Earth Engine like training webpage. Two more things I want to show you in the code editor before we move to the next thing is if you go back over to the help, there's a list of keyboard shortcuts, which is really handy. And there's also a suggest a data set button right here. And also new, a send feedback. So if you want to give them some feedback or you want to say, hey, I wish my data was in Earth Engine, will you please add it? There's a suggest a data set. You can add a data set and then other people can upvote it. And then the ones that get upvoted the most are the ones that get added, you know, next in order of priority, as long as they're public access. Okay, the other final place you can go is, I think, do we still have this? There used to be like a shared scripts, maybe that doesn't exist anymore. Do you guys see at the bottom of yours, you just have reader and writer? Oh, you have examples, do you have that? Yeah, so there should be examples of code snippets there that are fun to just kind of dink through if to see. They're ones that have been built by other people that are just available to play with, which is really fun. Like, what is the Landsat Explorer? What are linked maps? I don't know. Open it up and run that code and have a nice time checking it out. Okay, the other last question people always want to know right out of the gate is importing and exporting. Importing, exporting, I'm so sorry, one last place. Over here on the left, there's a docs tab, and these are like the actual computer science documentation that they write for each of the algorithms. So for example, you're like, man, random forest that Bernice and Shay were talking about is so cool, I want to run it in Earth Engine. You can type in random forest, and this is the actual like snippet of the algorithm that they use and any information arguments about it. Sometimes they have citations here too, you can look up papers and stuff. So there's many, many places to go for information about all the functions about Earth Engine and how it works and places to go to get help if you're trying to teach it to yourself. The other thing that's over on this side of the code editor is the assets tab. This is where you import your own images or tables, which is what they call vector data. And you can also upload directories and collections of images here. So that's how you do that. And then they're stored over here under your username, which is great. Okay, does anybody have any questions on this part? Okay, so some key points. This JavaScript code editor is a one-stop shop for accessing the data and conducting geospatial analysis, and it's all right in your browser. All you need is an internet login point to use it, and you don't have to go through the authentication process like you would if you were logging in through the Python with Python, because it's just like logging into Gmail. It's super easy. You can use a code editor to develop, share, and manage scripts. You can use a code editor to import, export, share, and manage your own personal raster and vector data sets, and of course to do analysis. And then there's tons of places to go to get help if you need help when you're building your code. Okay, how are we doing on time? We're at 11:10. What's our target finish time, Anthony? 48 minutes left. Okay, let's check and see what's up next. So that was episode introducing the code editor. I think we're gonna do one more together, and then I'm gonna let you guys play on your own. So you might have noticed that some of us around here are pretty obsessed with Landsat. and these are all the Landsat scenes that cover the US. What we're gonna do today is we are going to learn how to access these images and do the same thing that we did before, which is kind of filter them to a time and a region. But this time we're gonna do it to a watershed, and then we're gonna map an algorithm over the Landsat image. So in a lot of our different fields, people do this all the time. They'll calculate a wetness index, they'll calculate a snow index, they'll calculate a cloud one or an NDVI for vegetation. So we're gonna kind of walk through how to do that in this tutorial. And then for the rest of the time, I'm gonna let you guys pick the final ones to play with on your own. Okay, so let's go back to the code editor and let's open a new blank window. You can save the old one if you want. And the static versions of these codes, of course, are in your reader repository as well. So if you don't want to save your script that you just wrote, that's fine. And let's walk through this together. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to do is image collections. We kind of already talked about how to look at the different ones. And in this case, we are, yeah. Let's reload. Let me check here really quick. I think I, Oh yeah, so we're gonna load an image collection in a second, but before we do that, we wanna load a vector boundary. So as an environmental scientist, I often have a study area, and I wanna do something inside that study area. There's a lot of different ways to get vector data in GEE. So you can just upload shape, like old school shape files, directly into your personal assets, like I just showed you as a table, where you can create subfolders and set sharing permissions, so I can share my vector data with other people to run in their scripts. You can import an existing Google Fusion table. Has anyone used Fusion tables here before? It's kind of like Google's way of managing shapefiles. It's like a cross between Google Sheets and a shapefile. But it's a way that you can import data, and we'll do it in one of the later sessions. And there's links to do it on how to actually make a Fusion table if you want. So you can upload a shapefile, you can make a Fusion table, you can use an existing vector data set in Earth Engine, which is what we're going to do for this tutorial, or you can also manually just draw your own in Earth Engine in the code editor, which is what we just did in the first episode. So here, we want to use an existing vector data set, which is the U.S. watershed boundaries. So in order to load the vector data set, we're going to have to call it into the browser. And so I'm going to copy this, these commands right here. So what this is saying is it's saying, give me this feature collection. Here's the feature collection ID. This is something that lives inside Earth Engine in the cloud. And print it to show me what it is, and then add it to the map as watersheds. So I'm going to copy and paste that in, dump it. Oh, the other thing is, this was Earth Engine doesn't care if you use single or double quotes. Just make sure you do it consistently. So you have to use either one or the other. So here's my feature collection. You can see the columns, which are basic. That's like each of the attributes that any given watershed has. Features, that's each of the watersheds, so it's a list of all the watersheds. This one, for example, is 36,000 square kilometers. And then you can see an actual map of the watersheds is loading into my browser very slowly. You can click on any of the watersheds, and you can see the information about that watershed. So that's its feature number, here's its properties. The one I clicked on is called Western Lake Erie. You can find all this information about it. So we're going to use these watersheds. But you know what? We only want to do one watershed. And in particular, we're going to do this watershed, which is the watershed I grew up in, which is in Kansas. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to show you how to filter this feature collection using the metadata down to just one watershed. We're going to use this command right here. So I'm going to say take my feature collection, the watershed boundary data set, and filter the metadata, and give me the one whose name equals Republican. So I want the Republican watershed. And then with that watershed, I'm going to print it. And then I'm going to add it to the map, map by layer watershed. And also, I'm going to center the map on the watershed. So that way, when I run the code, it's going to take me to that watershed and not just stay zoomed out. OK, so click run. Hey, look, there it is. OK, so we should have two things now. We have all the watersheds in the US, like this. And then we also have my watershed that I want of interest. OK, so we filtered this feature collection down to this one area of interest. And now what we're going to do is we're going to load back our image collection, just kind of like what we did the first time. And we're going to filter it to this watershed. So I'm going to find this unique image ID or image collection ID. I'm going to load it as an image collection. I'm going to filter it to the watershed, and I'm going to filter it to this date range. Okay. So in this case, we're not doing any of the sorting or anything. So I'm still getting I'm getting the stack of images for that whole year. For that watershed. And if we go to console, you can see it printed, but it might get mad because it may be too many. No, it's cool. So it printed, it said, okay, there's 276 images were collected by Landsat over your watershed in 2017. Cool, that's cool. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna use a little function to map some clouds or to mask clouds because we wanna take those out. And I can talk to you for many hours about cloud masking in Landsat, but we're not going to do that. We're just going to run this code that's going to mask out the clouds for us in the interest of time. Please let me know if you want to chat more about this. But basically, Landsat has this really nice pixel QA band that the new atmospheric correction routine has that will allow you to filter to very specifically what you want in terms of unless you're trying to map clouds over snow. Sorry, Victoria. It has a lot of functionality. Yeah. But basically what we're saying is we're making a little function, and we're saying go to this pixel QA band, or we're saying go to the image, select the pixel QA band, and of that band, make a mask and mask out all the pixels that are cloudy. And then we map that function over the collection, so for each image we go through and we mask all the clouds out. And now we have this new collection called Landsat 8 Masked, and what we're going to do is we still have, what was it, 270 some images. We can't visualize all of them. So instead, we're just going to add the first one to the map. So I'm going to do map add layer. I have to cast it as an image. And I'm saying take this collection, take the first image, cast it as an image, and then add it to the map. Okay? And so we're going to run that and see what happens. And I think it should add. Yeah, perfect. So this is the original image. And then this is the image with the clouds masked. And you can see there was very cloudy, so there's nothing left. It's sort of a bummer. We could change the dates, and it would probably give us a different one. But there's an image from another year up in here, which is kind of what it would look like if we had. It depends on what dates you select, right? It's giving you the first one. So we happen to get a very cloudy one, which is sort of a bummer. OK, the next thing that we want to do is, for this image collection of all the images from 2017, we want to map an NDVI function of it over it. Okay, so this is the function that we're going to use. We're saying make a function. I'm going to pass an image to that function. And I'm going to return, I'm going to take that image. I'm going to calculate a normalized difference between these, the near infrared and the red bands. I'm going to rename this new band NDVI. And I'm going to add this new band back to my original image. Okay, so that's my function. Now, when we originally wrote this tutorial, they didn't have the normalized difference function. So instead, you had to code it out by actually manually subtracting, if anyone knows how NDVI works, subtracting and dividing the near infrared and the red bands. So there's an extra example showing you how to do it with like straight band math. But now there's this handy normalized difference function, and it's shorter, so let's use that. I'm going to copy this down here. So I've created my function. And now I'm going to map the function over the image collection. So I'm saying for every image, go through and do this, map NDVI over it, and make this new thing called Landsat 8 NDVI. Landsat 8 NDVI will be an image collection. Each image inside of it will be the original Landsat 8 image with this new band called NDVI. And of course, it's cloud mask because we already did that. Okay. So let's do this, and let's print one image and see that the band is still there. Although, you know what I'm going to do, because our first image was kind of a bummer? I'm going to change this to June to see if we can get a less cloudy image. So print NDVI first. And here's our image. And let's just double check. Did it actually add that band that we wanted? Boom. Yes, there's a new NDVI band now at the end of the image. And that's the one that we just calculated. Okay. So we've taken an image collection. We've filtered it to a specific region and date. We've masked the clouds over the whole collection. We've mapped an algorithm for NDVI over that whole image collection. And now, so we have this stack of images, but we know it's for the most of the year. So some of them are cloudy, some of them are not. I'm going to go back and change this to January so we get the full stack of the full year. And then what we're going to do next is we're going to take that whole stack and we're going to turn it into one image by making a composite. And there's this really slick thing you can do that's called a quality mosaic. And you can say, hey, take the stack of images and give me at each pixel the best pixel by this criteria. So the quality mosaic is saying, go to each pixel and find the best NDVI value, and that's going to make up our composite. There's a few different ways to do these mosaics and composites, so I encourage you to explore them. You can do max composites. This quality mosaic is another way to do it. There's a few different options. So let's go ahead and do that. So I'm saying, take my collection, make a quality mosaic using this band, and clip it to my watershed. So I don't want the whole US. I want just this watershed. And you know what? I can't quite remember if quality mosaic is max or median. So I'm going to go over here and I'm going to type in quality mosaic. Composites all the images using a quality band as a per pixel ordering function. That doesn't say if it's taking the highest value. I might look that up on the developers forum later. But for right now, let's just make this mosaic and see what it looks like. So I say take the collection, make it into a quality mosaic. And you'll notice that when I print quality mosaic, it doesn't like that. Cannot read property quality mosaic of undefined. Interesting. Oh, I think it's because I need to rename my. I pasted in the wrong place. That's why. That's really funny. Where was I at? Here we go. Sorry, I pasted it at the middle of my script. So let's try that again. So I'm saying make a new image. Nope, it's still giving me junk. I think I pasted it somewhere weird. Yeah. It doesn't like the Landsat 8 NDVI. Anyways, is this a personal problem or is everyone having this problem? Okay, good. It's just something about the way I pasted it. Okay, we're almost done, so I'm going to let you guys just keep rolling. And what you can do next is, actually, let me show you something, because this is a good learning thing. So I don't know what's going on. I pasted something weird. I wasn't doing a good job of live coding. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to my code editor. We're on 3, right, accessing imagery. And I'm going to load this script to bail me out, because I like being bailed out. But now, because we're only halfway through the tutorial, I don't want to run all the code. I just want to run the first part. So what I'm going to do is how you can block comment out stuff is you can select chunks of it and go like that. Okay. You can't actually see my hands. So it's a command double slash. Try it. See if you can get it to work. Command double slash. So you can't selectively select and highlight a chunk of code and run it. So what you do instead is you mask out all the code that you don't want to run, okay? So that's how that works. So I don't want to run any of the stuff at the bottom. I want to just run the stuff in the middle of the tutorial. So where we left off here is we made this composite. We defined a color palette for it. And you'll see down here in my visualization parameters, I'm adding the composite to the map. I'm telling it which band to look at. And I'm passing it these visualization parameters, including my color palette. And then I'm visualizing the composite with the map add layer. Okay. Oh, no, wait. I'm visualizing both of them, the true color and the NDVI with two different kind of visualization parameters. So you can see the NDVI and the true color composite for my watershed is kind of a little slow, but okay. I also forgot to mention that I think I mask it just to water because that's all I care about because I study water when we did the masking. The other really nifty thing is they've built all these UIs for you to visualize data. So you can see this code block here. You can copy and paste it into your editor. Or if you're running off the full version like I am, I've already ran it. And you can see that I've taken the collection, the original collection, and selected the NDVI band that I computed. And for my watershed, I've asked, what does it look like over time? And it shows you over here, these GUI, these charts over here are taking the NDVI over time for 2017, they're comparing it to a MODIS NDVI, and we've made these charts for you to do that. So, and if you go over here, you can pop the chart out. So this is the Landsat 8 NDVI for my watershed for 2017. So it went through that whole image collection and it pulled out the NDVI value. This one is for a different sensor, MODIS. It's a product, so it's an NDVI product. And you can see it's way smoother. They have daily data, not 16-day data. And it's also a nice product, so they've done a lot of the QAQC already, which is really nice. And I know, like I said, this part is going a little bit fast. We're not going through each of these code chunks individually, but I kind of just want to show you some of the things that you can do. All right, does anybody have any questions about any of this? The other thing about the chart is you're like, okay, well, what is it actually computing? What it's doing is it's computing the mean for each image. So it's just giving you the mean NDVI for that image for that date. All right, does anybody have any questions? So we've made some charts. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Caitlin.
I was wondering if you were to load in your own say shape files mm-hmm. in your study area, how does Google Earth Engine handle spatial information? Does it just automatically know?
Yeah.
It's so smart.
Yeah, okay. So I will I would like to point you to some extended reading because there, if you go to the developer's guide, basically it puts everything in the same projection and then just takes care of all of it for you. So as long as you're comfortable with that and you don't have any super special projection needs like you're working in the Arctic, sorry, David Sheen, then that's cool. It's no problem. Like it just sorts it out. In the developer's guide here, up there, there's some how Earth Engine works. And there's a scale one and a projections one that I would highly encourage you to read because that will give you a little bit more insight into exactly, you know, what they're doing in the back end. But yeah, it's pretty cool. And if you have like really in-depth questions about it, ask the developers because they can explain kind of in more detail about how they're actually doing all of it on the back end. But it's pretty much they sort of manage it for you, and as long as you don't have special needs, then it should work out. But it sort of depends on what you're trying to do. Okay, last thing. You love this NDVI composite, and you can't wait to share it with your advisor, but they're not on Earth Engine, so what are you going to do? You can export the image. So this next little code block is showing you how you can export an image. And so you can select the band, and you can export a new raster with just that band. You can specify the scale. You can clip it to that watershed again. And here, as you're exporting it, you can specify what reference system you want to use, what Google folder you want it to go through. You can add some arguments like max pixels to help it not time out. So there's a couple different ways that you can export data. So let's actually go to the, let's see if we can actually try to export the composite image. So I'm gonna uncomment out this code. Let's see here. In this case, this is the first thing that people try to do. They're like, I want to export my raster. And I'm going to tell you in a second that it's a bad idea. But first, I'm going to show you how to do it so you can at least try it on your own. Okay, so I'm taking my composite. I'm trying to send it. There's two things. You can either send it to Google Drive. You can send it to Google. I think you can send it to Google Cloud Storage. Or you can send it to your own asset. So it's saved in Earth Engine over here. When I click Run and I have this export command, does anyone notice anything change in the code editor? Any secret changes? Things flashing at you? Color changes, tasks. If you click on tasks, you can see there's two new tasks in the queue. And the reason why they do this is because it's really easy to say export stuff, and then you're trying to export the whole Landsat 8 collection, and they're like, no, 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 you don't want to do that. So they queue it up as a task, and then you have to go over here and you have to hit run. Otherwise, it won't actually export. And they made this new widget. So when you click run, this little widget pops up, and you can tell it what scale you want it at. You can tell it where you want it to go. Again, another case in which you can actually code everything out in JavaScript and say all these commands, or you can just use this little widget and just say it right here. The other really cool thing, they keep adding things. The pyramiding policy, I think, is new since the last time I tried to do this, so that's pretty cool. Is that when you run the task, it'll be assigned a task ID, and you can also use that task ID to troubleshoot. So you can post it on the developer's forum and say, hey, here's my task ID. It didn't work. It timed out. Can someone help me explain why? And the task ID is also linked to the source code for the task, which is pretty cool. All right, the other last thing I will say, though, is in most cases, it's a bad idea to export raster data from Earth Engine. Like, try to think of a way to not do it. So if there's a way that you can extract your data to points and export it as a CSV, you'll probably have a lot happier of a research life than if you're trying to get these images out. If you do need the image, you can do it, right? I can export this raster, and depending on the size of it and how much time I have, it might actually go. If it's a really small raster, it'll be no problem. But you can't just like get big chunks of imagery and export them. You'll get memory errors. Things will time out. And that's why people use Python, because they build these little wrappers, and it just keeps pushing the task overnight and kind of gets around some of these limits that you get with this browser interface. But if there's a way, like I said, you can turn it into a CSV file. Like if you have sample points and you're extracting the numbers at those sample points, then it'll go a lot faster and it'll be a lot smoother for you. Okay. We've covered so many things in this tutorial, so many just kind of getting started steps. Does anybody have any questions before we move on? Okay, so we have a little bit of time left, and what I want to do is there's three more episodes left. There's temporal and spatial reducers, supervised classification of satellite imagery, and time series analysis. So here's what I want folks to do, okay? At your tables, I want you to divide into three groups, one for each of the remaining episodes. And depending on the number of people, you might want to move to a new table or work in a group of one or a group of three. It doesn't really matter. But divide it up so that way everybody's doing one of these different tutorials. And all I want you to do is go to the tutorial, open the live link, or go to your shared repository and open up the stored code there, and just run the code. Don't even worry about reading through the tutorial yet. Run the code, see what it does. Look through the code, look at the tutorial, see what the tutorial says, and then after, we're going to do this for about 5 or 10 minutes, and then I'm going to have you guys come back together as a table group and share out with your table group what you saw when you ran that code. And the purpose of this is as follows. When I do this tutorial, a lot of people are brand new to Earth Engine, and I want them to have the tiny building blocks to get started, but there's like crazy advanced functionality too. And in some of these tutorials, we hit on that advanced functionality, so I want you to at least see like what it could look like if you want to take some of these more advanced steps, okay? So this will give you a chance to play with some of the more advanced analyses that's available to you. Anybody have any questions? Okay, all right, your marks is set, go! You have like 10 minutes. Let me put up an online timer. Did people have a lot of questions? Oh, sorry, turn this off. everybody. I hope you had a chance to play a little bit. We're going to take a time out and stop what you're doing really quick. And what I want you to do is I want you to go around your table, and I'm only going to get, you have like 1 to 2 minutes to do this. 1 to 2 minutes to show your computer to your group and explain what you looked at. Just say, hey, this is what I did, this is what I learned, like that, just super quick. And we're going to go just around in your table groups. That way everybody kind of gets a chance to see what the other episodes were that they didn't work on. Okay, on your marks, get set, and go. 1 to 2 minutes per group, really quick. What's the
like the little
Yay, awesome. I think most people had a chance to share out what they were working on. I saw some really cool demos and people using things I didn't even have in the tutorials, which is super exciting. There we go. Couple last closing thoughts, and we're going to do one more activity before we go to lunch. The last module in the tutorial is a wrap-up, and definitely like bookmark this page because it's pages to bookmark. The closing thoughts are, in this tutorial, you got an overview to Earth Engine, why you might use it. We learned how to navigate the JavaScript code editor. We practiced accessing the image collections that are online in Google Earth Engine. And then you guys got to play with some different types of analysis. So there's links to all the episodes here. You can go back. You can look at the code. You can follow the links inside the tutorials to get more information on any of them. But before I leave you, I want to make sure to that you bookmark these web pages for help for when you're trying to do this on your own. So the code editor, that code.googleearthengine.com or whatever we typed in the top, that's where you go to actually do the analysis. The data catalog is where you go to look up data sets. If you are curious, like I was just working with Lucy, she's like, I want to calculate NDVI. She doesn't even have to calculate it. There's already a product. Look it up. It's amazing. So check the data catalog, because whatever you're working on, the data set might be in there that's useful. The developer's guide is the closest thing to the manual that we looked at that a couple times today. And then the developer's forum, of course, is where you can go to post questions. One thing that I do want to say about the developer's forum is when you are posting a question, make sure that you include that link to your script. So save your script, click get link, and take this URL. And when you go post in the forum, post your question and post a link to your code. Because the first thing that the people on the forum are going to say is like, what's your code? What did you write? And so you share that link with them, and that way they can see the work that you've actually done to date. There's some additional learning resources listed here. And then for people who have more in-depth questions, like if you have, more detailed questions, there's a great debugging guide. Noel basically got tired of answering the same questions over and over again, so he wrote a debugging guide for us, which is a thing to read before you have problems. And that would be very helpful instead of waiting until you have problems. There's an under-the-hood thread that's pretty cool where people get kind of in deep about what's going on Earth Engine. And then, of course, read the paper to kind of get the broad overview. So the key points of today, it's a planetary-scale geospatial analysis platform. It has a wide collection of documentation and example codes. You can find there's a forum to go post and answer questions. And then there's lots of resources inside the platform itself. And so it's a great tool. It's a great tool to look at the Earth. Anybody have any final questions? Okay, to do our wrap up today, I'm gonna have you guys get up and stretch your legs a little bit. So what I want you to do is, before we go to lunch, we have 6 minutes. So please listen carefully for the cues. We're gonna answer three questions. Question one, question two, and question three. And for each question, you're gonna find a new partner, and I'm gonna cue you to find a new partner. So what I want you to do now is stand up, find somebody you've never talked to, and you're gonna answer this question with them right now. On your marks, get set, go. Find somebody new to say hi to, and then have a discussion about this question. Hi, you need a partner?
Victoria.
Oh, she needs a partner. Okay, you have 30 seconds left. All right, nice job, you guys. Tell your partner thank you so much for the combo. And find a new person for the next question. Raise your hand if you need a partner. If there's anybody else who's lonely, I think she's. Raise your hand if you still need a partner. I'm waiting for a partner. Do you guys all need partners, I think? And you've been together before, but. Yeah. Are you hiding, Jonathan? What do you think? What'd you play with today since you didn't need the basics? Did you jump into something else?
It's not done. I was actually starting to write different classifiers for our TIFF, our actual project.
Very cool. Very cool.
Typical part of ESRM 430.
Oh, that's so good to do that. Yeah. Right, you have 30 seconds left. You guys done? Which is very efficient. What are the connections that you saw? Yeah. Cool. All right, find a new partner. Tell your partner thank you. Find somebody new. It's time to go to lunch. Break it up. Find somebody new to talk to. Tell them thank you. How do I turn my mic on? If you need a partner, raise your hand so people know.
Do you have a new question?
Yeah. Last question. Thanks, Anthony.
It's okay. I have two more things before we break.
Okay. Cool. You have a mic, right?
Nice work.
Tired of talking to them. I think that was.
I like making them do the cognitive work to connect it to the other tutorials. Basically, I want it to end in them exporting something.
I'll close them out and then. All right, thank you guys so much. Give yourselves a round of applause. Nice job. That was awesome.
Nice.
All right, wrap up your conversations. Thank you guys so much for participating today. It was really good. High five your partner if you want to. Nice work. You made it through another tutorial, even though your brain is dead.
Let's thank Catherine and everyone helping out with this great tutorial.
Yeah, and Anthony has a couple announcements before we hop out for lunch. So if you don't mind turning your attention up here for him, thank you.
I just have two more things. I know everyone's hungry. I have two more favors to ask. One is we've received a fair bit of press on this Hackweek paper recently, and we have a science writer from